Welcome back after that brief pause. We are continuing with our session on the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to look at the climate change bill at stage two. So moving on now, I'm going to call Amendment 17 in the name of Patrick Harvey, grouped with Amendments 18 and 21 and 56. Patrick Harvey, please can you move Amendment 17 and speak to the amendments in the group? Patrick.
Convener, as with my previous amendment, this amendment addresses the carbon impact of major capital projects. And as I indicated earlier, there were two potential places that could be inserted in the bill. This does it in one of them. Given the Cabinet Secretary's earlier comments about willingness to work with me to produce an alternative, I probably don't have very much to say on the amendment at this point. Obviously, I'll move it so that the rest of the group can be debated. But if the Cabinet Secretary wants to say anything further about any alternative approaches that she has in mind or issues that she wants to explore, I'd be happy to discuss that either now or later.
It looks like it's later, Patrick. So we'll call Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 18 and any other amendments in the group. Mark.
Yeah, thanks. So Amendment 18 is about ensuring that the climate change plans state what the expected emissions reductions are of each policy. I think, you know, we're now recognising that this is good practice. It's what the UK CCC have been recommending. I think this amendment just ensures that going forward in climate change plans, we will actually see that detail, which I don't think we've ever had up to now. It's all in the past. I think government has said, well, this is too difficult to do. It's too difficult to work out. We can't make it that transparent. But I think going forward, you know, we absolutely have to see that transparency, because it could be that some policies deliver quite unexpectedly large reductions in emissions, while others may, result in perhaps lesser reductions. So, you know, it's important to see that, and that's what this amendment does. Improves scrutiny, improves transparency.
Thank you very much, Mark. I'm going to call on Graham Simpson to speak to Amendment 21, which is in the name of Maurice Golden. Graham.
Yeah, thanks. Amendment 21 requires that the climate change plan costs and benefits assessment is broken down by reference to the period covered by a Scottish carbon budget in which those costs and benefits are expected to arise. The best practice approach of the Scottish Government already achieves the sentiments of this amendment, but it's not codified or a requirement for future governments. We appreciate the technical challenges in meeting this duty in an efficient way, as, for example, some policies may straddle two carbon budget periods, but we think it's possible to disaggregate this between carbon budget periods.
Thank you very much, Graham. Sarah Byock, would you speak to Amendment 56 and any other amendments in the group? Sarah.
Thank you, convener. My amendment is, I think, absolutely vital to ensuring that the next climate change plan is robust. And the effect of the amendment is that it places a requirement on the Scottish Government to quantify their anticipated emission reductions in measurable terms, i.e. putting distinct, tangible outcomes into the climate change plan. Very much thank the Cabinet Secretary to support me in the wording of this amendment to make sure that these outcomes will be measured in groups rather than anticipated emissions per policy. And that's to enable a crossover between policies where you've got multiple proposals which will work together to reduce emissions. I think the effect remains the same, though, that we should see in the climate change plan real actions that we can then measure each year to see the impact of each one, so that we get more dynamic and impactful adjustments where the Scottish Government of the day is falling short. And I think the key part of the amendment is the phrase "in measurable terms," and that ties the Scottish Government to making the outcomes more than just hopes and dreams, but something which can be scrutinised for efficiency and effectiveness each year. I do believe that my amendment's a more effective version of what I think Mark Ruskell's Amendment 18 is trying to deliver, and I think the emphasis on making the climate change plan more robust and helpful is right, but I think my amendment is better in terms of the measurability aspect. but it's not also, it's also not containing the flexibility that I think we need, which is in my amendment through the groupings. I very much agree with the sentiment of Patrick Harvey's Amendment 17, that major capital projects need to consider climate impact. Actually, I think all capital projects should, because you should think about the accumulation of impact, and there's something about best practice, learning from different projects. I wouldn't put it on the face of the bill. So I hope that we come back to this when we scrutinise the climate change plan next year. I think that's a better place for actually tackling those issues. So just to conclude, Convener, I'd urge the committee to support Amendments 56 in my name and to write into the face of the bill the requirement to go further than the Scottish Government has previously in committing to measurable, impactful actions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Just looking round, no one else wants to contribute to this debate, so Cabinet Secretary, it's your turn.
Thank you, Convener. So the Government supports Amendments 56 and 21, but can't support Amendment 18, and I've already said I want to work with Patrick Harvey on the substance of his Amendment 17, and pleased that he's not willing to press it today, because I recognise the point that Patrick Harvey is making. Support the idea that we set our approach to assessing the emissions associated with capital projects, but the amendment as it's written doesn't sufficiently define what a major capital project is, so I think we can work together on something ahead of stage three, I hope so, and get something that everyone's comfortable with by stage three. Mark Ruskell's Amendment 18 and Sarah Boyett's amendment covered such similar ground on having climate change plans break down. Sarah Boyett came to me with the intention and the approach that she wanted to take and work with the government in getting the wording into a place that we're happy to support. I'll maybe leave my remarks on that amendment there. Amendment 21, I just want to say Amendment 56 better reflects the intentions, I think, of what quite a few members came to me and wanted to see in this bill. So I would urge that members support Amendment 56 over the Amendment 18, because I agree with Sarah Boyett's approach there. Amendment 21, the best practice approach. Yes.
Thank Cabinet Secretary for intervening. I'm just wondering if she could just explain very simply what the groupings of policies would actually look like, because I suppose a concern that I would have is that can perhaps mask the transparency around what policies in certain areas, you know, would achieve, depending on how things are grouped together. And that has been, of course, a problem, as she recognises, the whole time with these climate plans. It's been very difficult to see what individual policies have achieved.
Well, I mean, it's maybe for Ms Boyack to talk to her own amendment, but what we liked about it is that it accepts the principle of your amendment, but allows for it to be policies to be grouped where necessary, which actually I think is actually going to provide a lot more transparency. So I think that it has a very similar intention to your amendment, but we like the idea of the groupings, and that's why we have worked with Sarah on that, and I'm sure she would want to explain why she took the approach she did. But I'm hopeful. I hope that Mr Ruskell can see that by voting for Sarah Boyack's amendment, that he is really getting what he wants in the bill. Here. I think I have come to the end of my remarks. I'll just say I'm happy to support Amendment 21.
Thank you much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to ask now Patrick Harvey to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 17. Patrick.
Thank you, Convener. I don't have anything further to add. I'm happy to work with the Minister on an alternative, and I would ask permission to withdraw 17.
Okay, Patrick Harvey wishes to withdraw Amendment 17. Does any member object? No one objects. Thank you. Now, I'm just going to say we're going to go through a series of quite a lot of voting, so I'll do it slowly in the hope that we can all get this right, having been recharged after lunch. So I call Amendment 18 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 17. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 21 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 17. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question, therefore, is Amendment 21 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 56 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 17. Sarah Boyack to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 56 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. We've now reached Amendment 19 in the name of Mark Ruskold, already debated with Amendment 55. As previously advised, whilst this amendment can be moved, the question on it cannot be put. Mark Ruskold to move or not move?
Can't move, won't move.
I'm sure there's a song there somewhere. So I'm now going to move to call Amendment 20 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 55. Mark Ruskell to move or not
moved.
Okay, the question is Amendment 20 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 58 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 55. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I now call Amendment 22 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 55. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 23 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 38. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 48 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 38. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 48 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. There are 6 votes for. There is 1 abstention. Therefore, the amendment is agreed. Which one was that? Okay, I call Amendment 57 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 38. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 57 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 63 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 60. Douglas Lumsden to move or not moved?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 63 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who wish to abstain. There are 3 votes for, there are 3 votes against, and there is 1 abstention. I will use my casting vote. The amendment is agreed. I therefore call Amendment 64 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with Amendment 62. I think, Douglas Lumsden, you're moving or not moving.
Apologies, I was caught off guard. Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 37 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 52. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 45 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 52. Graham Simpson to move or not moved?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 45 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 49 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with Amendment 62. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 50 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with Amendment 62. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 4 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 25 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 55. Mark Ruskell to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
No, we're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There is one vote for, there are six votes against, therefore Amendment 25 is not agreed. I call Amendment 26 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 55, Mark Ruskell to move not or moved. Not moved? Sorry?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 27 in the name of Patrick Harvey in a group on its own. Patrick Harvey, can I ask you to move and speak to Amendment 27? Patrick.
Thank you, Convener. And I know we're coming to the end. I promise not to keep you very long, but I'd like to go back to the debates in 2009 on the first Climate Change Act. As it happens, amendment sessions which took place in this room, and I was sitting where you are, Convener, and one of the arguments that I made in relation to that first act was that there needs to be a clear connection between climate targets as we were framing them then, which would be climate carbon budgets now, and the Scottish Government's financial budget, the budget we pass every year in relation to the money that's being spent on investments and public services. And that argument was agreed. It led to an amendment which became section 94 of the legislation. And I think it was acknowledged then, including by government, that it was a first stab at a methodology to how you would connect those climate targets with the government's spending plans. I don't think it's ever been perfect. I'm not suggesting that it hasn't been refined and improved to some extent, but the methodology has always placed a little bit too much emphasis on the most direct connections about the emissions that are generated by the spending of the money, rather than by the effect that that has on the economy and the emissions that will be generated as a result. So I'm seeking to expand, this section as it will apply now to the carbon budgets as opposed to the climate targets that existed before. I'm retaining the requirement for a statement that will set out the direct and indirect impact on greenhouse gas emissions of the activities to be funded by virtue of the proposals, that being the financial budget. But I'm adding in two additional elements. One is about the financial resources being made available to ensure that the Scottish carbon budget target for the particular period will be met. So it's not just about an assessment of the budget, it's a specific statement about how the measures to meet the carbon budget themselves will be funded. And the other change, and I think this is probably the more significant change, is to require some independent scrutiny of that statement about the connection between the carbon budget and the financial budget. This is not to cast aspersions on the current or any particular government between 2009 and now. But there's a reasonable expectation, I think, that Parliament should be setting that the government's own assessment of this connection between spending and emissions should be independently scrutinised. And it might be that the body or person that was identified by the government would, for example, be the Fiscal Commission or another existing body. I'm not suggesting creating something new, but giving an independent body, a politically independent body, the responsibility to scrutinise what the government is saying about this really important question. If we're setting carbon budgets, if we're laying out a climate change plan, is the action necessary to meet those budgets? Is the action set out in the plan going to be funded? And we need to be scrutinising that question every year at every year's financial budget. Yes, happily.
Grateful to Patrick Harvey for giving way. So, I mean, I think he sets out a reasonable position that we want to make sure that there's adequate funding available for the measures that are going to make the difference. But would he recognise that not all of the financial resources will flow from government, so we are going to need investment from the private sector, for example. So is he able to say something about that? Because I just have a concern that the amendment maybe doesn't fully reflect the reality that not all of the finance is government finance, and how does his amendment sit with that?
Thank you. No, that's a perfectly fair comment, and indeed it's not only the private sector, but we'll also require the contribution of local government, of the UK government, our entire economy, in fact. The point I'm making is in relation to the annual political process of setting a budget for the Scottish Government, as we debate it through Parliament every year, it does have a very substantial impact on our ability to deliver the Scottish Government's own policies and proposals in the climate change plan, and thereby to make the greatest contribution it can to achieving those carbon budgets. And so the budget, the finance budget, needs to be scrutinised in that way by Parliament, and that scrutiny by Parliament will be its most effective and best informed if there's been an independent assessment of what the government is setting out. I don't honestly know what the government's reaction to this proposal is going to be, whether they're going to be open to it or not, but I genuinely would urge the committee to consider the value of applying some independent scrutiny at that stage when the government tells us in future of what it thinks of this this argument.
Thank Patrick Harvey for taking the intervention. I just wanted to clarify the last paragraph of the amendment, which says that ministers must take steps to ensure the document laid has been independently reviewed by a person with appropriate financial expertise. Is it Patrick Harvey's intention that should just be one individual, or does he mean that it should be a body? And how do you assess if it is one, if it is a person, an individual, how do you assess what is meant by appropriate financial expertise?
Thank you. The form of words has been suggested by parliamentary draftspeople on this. My understanding and my intention, as I expressed it to them, was that this would apply to a body such as the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and this would be captured by the form of words that's proposed.
Sorry. Would the member take an intervention from me?
Of course.
It's just, I'm wondering how else, if the Parliament doesn't have a chance to scrutinise whether there's sufficient money available, whether we're ever going to reach the targets, because surely money will drive whether we can reach those targets. Is that what you're driving at? And if it is, I wonder how the government will look at it. I mean, I'd be interested in your views.
Yeah, I think as Monica Lennon also suggested, the spending proposals in each year's finance budget are not the only factor, but a very, very major factor in whether the Scottish Government's intended policy priorities that are designed to deliver on a carbon budget will in fact be met. You know, if we set out those policies and then fail to fund them, then we can have no confidence at all, even of giving ourselves a reasonable chance of meeting what's set out in the carbon budget. So the principle here is to give Parliament the greatest level of informed analysis, independently informed analysis, of what the government is asking us to approve every year when we pass a finance budget. Is it going to be able to adequately fund the climate change policies that have been set out? Is it going to give us a chance of meeting the carbon budget? And I give way to Bob Doris.
I thank Patrick Harvey for giving way. I fully appreciate what Mr Harvey is trying to achieve with this amendment. There's a lot of moving parts within the finances required to meet climate targets. I think Monica Lennon outlined quite a lot of that. So there's UK government direct funding. There's Barnett consequentials from the UK government. There's in-year revisions, unexpected, that can happen to the Scottish budget from the UK government, the Scottish government's politicians itself. There's local authorities. There's the private sector. There's consumers and the public paying more directly and indirectly. So the idea, Mr Harvey, of landing on a precise total or quantum that would be the Scottish government contribution to that may in itself be a movable feast. You reflect upon that, Mr Harvey, and how could we reconcile that within the amendments that's been proposed here?
Thank you, Bob Doris. I mean, I suppose I would suggest there's a comparison with other aspects of budget scrutiny. For example, the government produces equality impact assessments in relation to the budget. Now, no one would suggest that the achievement of equality in our society is solely determined by Scottish Government policies, that it's unaffected by the private sector, by the UK Government, or by other factors. But it's a perfectly reasonable expectation that Parliament should place on government that its own spending plans are scrutinised in relation to their likely impact on equality. And the comparison here is simply to require government to produce a statement or a document setting out the financial resources being made available by virtue of the budget to ensure that the Scottish carbon budget target for the particular period will be met, and for that document to be independently scrutinised. I genuinely would struggle to suggest to accept any suggestion that Parliament's scrutiny of the finance budget would be weaker for the provision of that document and its independent scrutiny.
Thank you.
I move Amendment 27.
Thank you. I'm just looking to see if any other member wants to contribute. Cabinet Secretary, it's over to you.
Thank you. So Amendment 27 has two aspects, namely information on expenditure being directed at carbon budgets and annual financial budgets, and an independent review of such information. And I want to say from the outset that I completely understand why Patrick Harvey has brought forward an amendment which requires greater information about the emissions associated with spend. I understand that. I understand the arguments for that. But the climate change plan's already required to provide cost estimates for the policies that are included in that plan. And the government publishes a statutory carbon assessment of the budget. I think Patrick Harvey mentioned this, required by Section 94 of the 2009 Act. Subsequent to that happening, I want to just outline some of the things the government are doing to try and give more information in this space. The joint budget review by the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament is improving transparency on the budget and climate change funding with a new taxonomy on climate change spending. And the Scottish Government separately is just about to complete our pilot of the net zero assessment with a view to rolling out that approach in 2025 across all new significant Scottish Government spending decisions. So that will provide greater visibility of those areas that contribute to emissions and the aid decision-making process. The joint budget review and net zero assessment are already, I think, providing significant improvements, but particularly the end of that pilot being rolled out in 2025, I think will make all the difference. Now, I want to talk to some of the practicalities. Yes, I will.
I'm grateful. I wonder if she could just indicate the work that she's talking about that's under development there. Is it the government's intention and commitment that that would be subject to independent scrutiny by a body other than government in order to ensure that Parliament's
I won't answer because I don't actually know for sure what that independent scrutiny is or whatever, and I would need to actually get back. But we can have a discussion about that, and maybe that's an area in which we could improve. I just want to talk to the practicalities of the independent review and what Mr. Harvey's suggesting. So the tight timescales for publishing the budget wouldn't allow time for an independent review. Obviously, we know the window between, the Scottish budget has been finalised after the UK budget's been announced. And in practicality, the current carbon assessment work associated with that budget would only be finalised about 48 hours before the budget is announced in Parliament and the publication of the budget, because that's the timescale that we're working on. I don't see where we would have time for an independent review of that, even if the information could be shared with Parliament. When would that independent review take place? Now, the sort of like sentiment behind it about having more information, as I said at the outset, I understand, and I would like to work with Mr. Harvey on how we can strengthen that. Yes.
The timescale is potentially tight for the introduction of a budget. Presumably, there would be opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny of that budget to actually include the wider environmental and climate impacts.
Yeah, and that means that the information we need to discuss whether or not you think the information that's provided as part of the budget that I've already mentioned, the information that's already in the sort of like the joint budget review, the information that will be in the rollout of the approach that's taken about Scottish Government spending generally, whether that would be sufficient for Parliament to have that enhanced scrutiny. So I think that there's room for manoeuvre in the substance of Amendment 27. But as it stands at the moment, I think the biggest issue I have with it is the practicality of actually delivering on what's in the amendment being almost impossible to achieve. So with that, I'll probably say to Patrick Harvey that, again, this is another amendment that I'm happy to discuss with them ahead of stage three.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for taking the intervention. I was just trying to think also, obviously, the financial budget is made up of the capital budget as well. I'm just trying to think how that would potentially work with this, because I would imagine that would be a lot more work to work out what the carbon impact of that capital project or programme would be. And then I guess that potentially would mean budgets then having to come back maybe months later, because maybe the carbon side of things doesn't sort of match up. I'm just trying to think, as you say, the practicalities, how it would or could work.
Yeah, and given what Mr. Harvey has said about, it's not just about the emissions impact of, say, the construction of something. It's be the long-term impact, and that obviously gets a little bit more complicated as well. But I think as it's drafted at the moment, I understand the intention. Parliament would like more deeper analysis of the carbon impact of government spend. And I understand that. I've set out how government has moved in those areas. And I'm hopeful that the pilot that is just about to complete will actually provide a lot more of that information. I think I need to have a discussion with Mr. Harvey, but what more you'd want to see in that space that's actually practical, it can practically be delivered, I think, is my main point here.
You just take a brief intervention from me. Yeah. One of the policies Mr. Harvey had when he was a minister was that local housing by 2032 would reach EPCC. And that would be obviously built into your heat in buildings, which would then have implications on the budget that was given to councils. Highland Council have indicated that the cost for that would be £360 million, which is quite a big proportion of their budget, over half, I think roughly half their annual budget. So what I would like to know is, when you're setting these carbon budgets and the policies, how can the Parliament follow through to see whether that money is being made available to local government, and how will they have confidence? Surely this amendment goes some way to work it through for it. Perhaps I've got the wrong end of what Mr. Harvey's trying to
do. I don't want to get into detail of the actual particular example that you've given, but I think that what you've done is effectively underlined what Monica Lennon has just put forward, is that there's a lot of moving parts in how something is financed. So something as large a project as what you've just discussed would probably not be solely financed by central government, local government. There might be private investment involved as well. There might be housing associations involved as well. So I think that's what you've outlined is some of the difficulties around this. It's been useful to have the debate. I can't support this amendment at the moment. I'd urge the committee not to support it, because I think that in practical terms, it's not achievable in the way that it's set out. But also, there's quite a lot of work that has been done, and indeed is just about to complete, that possibly the committee will be content to see having made the difference in terms of the information that's available in this issue.
Sorry, are you looking at me now? You answered my question. Is that you finished?
Yes.
And can I move back to Mr. Harvey? Sorry, just so I wondered if it was just another hesitation, but obviously not. Mr. Harvey, back to you to wind up and push or withdraw your amendment.
Thank you, Convener. Thank the Cabinet Secretary for responding and others for contributing to the discussion. I'm tempted to press this to the vote, partly in order to gauge the level of support there is on the committee for it. It may be that I haven't done enough to persuade people of this precise amendment, but I'd like to get a sense of that, and if not, then perhaps explore bringing something else at stage three. But if the committee is convinced that an amendment is required that places some additional requirements on the face of the bill at this point, if the committee was to agree to it, then it would leave the onus on the government. If they wanted to refine that at stage three, they would then be in the position of needing to convince the majority of Parliament of the need for a change. And so I think I would be I would prefer that we at least put the question to the vote at the moment. So I press Amendment 27.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 27 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
No, we're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. So there is one vote for, there are four votes against, and there's two abstentions. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. Now I call Amendment 51 in the name of Brian Whittle in a group all on its own. Brian Whittle is not here, so yeah. Graham Simpson's going to move it for him and speak to Amendment 51.
Well, I'm not, but I do understand this.
Oh, I thought you were.
No. I think Mr. Lumsden is going to. But
good. Well, as you both understand it, I apologise for looking at you, Graham. Obviously, been too long a day. Yeah. Douglas, I apologise. You should be speaking to Amendment 51.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. And the last one, and it is quite brief. It's really just moving regulations into the affirmative from what's proposed in the bill is affirmative and some negative procedures. I think we all probably agree that climate change is too important an issue to not give it any supplementary legislation, give it full scrutiny, and I think moving it to affirmative will give it the scrutiny that the regulations deserve. I'm happy to move it.
Thank you, and sorry for causing some confusion. Looking around if anyone else would like to add to that. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to add anything?
Thank you. I'm sorry to end on a negative note, because the government can't support Amendment 21, and I'll explain why. 51.
Secretary.
It's been a long day. It would make all ancillary regulations, no matter how minor, subject to affirmative procedure. That means that even something simple as maybe swapping the words out, interim target for Scottish carbon budget target in an SSI would take up more time in the parliamentary parliamentary time, including the committee. Section 5 of the bill follows the standard model that all ancillary powers have had for a number of years, and that's that the affirmative procedure applies to regulations modifying primary legislation, and the negative procedure applies to everything else. This long-settled approach respects the balance between the importance of parliamentary oversight and the proper use of parliamentary time. And indeed, it's the approach of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that they have endorsed generally, and in specific in relation to this bill, as outlined in paragraph 47 of the DPLR Committee's Stage 1 report. So I urge the committee not to support this amendment.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And I'm going to move to Douglas Lumsden. I think I've got it right this time to wind up. Douglas.
Yeah, nothing more to really add, just saying that I'm bringing this forward to try and have better scrutiny. Happy to move it.
Thank you. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 51 be agreed. Are we all agreed? No. We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are two votes for, there are five votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. The question is that Section 5 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 6 and 7 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. The question is that the long title be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed, and that ends stage two consideration of the bill. Can I just say, before I just wind up, and The stage three debate is obviously, I think, next week, and the amendments for stage three, I'm just looking at the clerks, I think have to be lodged by Friday at noon of this week. I would personally like to thank all the committee members for taking the exceptional extra work required to get to where we are today on fairly short notice, on a short notice bill, and for all those people who gave evidence to the committee to help us with our deliberation, and for those members of the Parliament who engaged and submitted amendments at stage two. So thank you very much. Before I conclude, next week we go to... I was going to make some comment about some place we're going to. We're going to next week to land reform. That's where we're going to. And we will continue taking evidence on that. And we have an outside visit on Thursday night and Friday this week as part of the land reform bill. So thank you, everyone. And that concludes our meeting.